He's a British character actor who it seems is always in demand. Timothy Spall is currently in the country and we'll speak with him in a moment, but let's look back at a few of his most memorable roles.
All right, lads, how you feeling?
Timothy Spall is one of Britain's most recognisable actors and has done it all in his 40-plus year long career. From the Who-inspired drama Quadrophenia on the big screen.
Oh, that's bollocks, three of a kind, don't beat that.
To the long-running television comedy Auf Wiedersehen, Pet.
Yeah, he looked very beady, he did when Nev went off with her.
He's a familiar face in some of Hollywood's big-budget epics.
Apparently he refuses to fight against Captain Oda.
And then there's his role as the ultimate rat, Peter Pettigrew, in the Harry Potter franchise.
Willingly sacrificed.
Spall won universal acclaim in the 2014 film based on the life of British painter William Turner.
Where has it got you, this hobby? Painting these squalid industrial scenes that nobody wants to buy.
It's not a hobby.
And now he's picked up the paintbrush again for his latest film, a drama on 20th century artist L.S. Lowry.
Am I an artist? I'm a man who paints.
Please welcome Timothy Spall. Reflecting a bit on Quadrophenia, which was a way back when. Did you hear the stuff that Pete Townsend said about John Entwistle and Keith Moon earlier?
No, I didn't, should I know?
Well, he said they were hopeless musicians.
He said he was that, glad they're dead. They were so hard to work with.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. It's
a bit hard.
Is that surprising?
I don't know what to say about that.
Not surprising to you in any way?
I'm surprised now. Yeah. I wonder what was. He obviously had an axe to grind there, didn't he?
Clearly.
Or possibly an album to sell. One of the two.
Yeah. I'm sorry to hear that. I hope they don't mind. I'm sure they do. But there we are.
Onto your latest movie. One reviewer said you and your co-star Vanessa Redgrave are two titans at the top of your game. Now this artist
Compliment. Oh, well, I've had a lot worse.
Can you paint a picture? See what I did there?
Of the artist
you are playing in this film.
Yeah. Well, what's surprising about him is that he's now nationwide. He's known. You go into a doctor's waiting room, and there'll be a copy of him on the wall, or one of his paintings. You'll get a mug at Christmas time. It'll have a little Lowry on it. But it took him a long, long time to become well known. It wasn't until he was in his 50s. But what's remarkable about him is that most of his life, he devoted to caring for his mother. He was a single, sole carer of his mother. And he was a rent collector right up to the point when he was an associate member of the Royal Academy of Art. And he was absolutely devoted to his mother, looked after her, was trained by her to be enthralled to his every whim, and she never missed an opportunity to tell him how much she hated his paintings.
Oh, God.
Every day, as much as she could, and how embarrassing he was.
Wow. Yeah.
So pretty much like everyone's mother.
Yeah. Mother of the year.
To a large or lesser degree. My mum was very supportive, so I was lucky.
this is actually your second role, playing a real-life artist.
Yeah,
you played
it is.
Turner, and you did 2 years of painting and artist lessons for that role?
I did. Mike Lee, the director and deviser and writer of the... Yeah, he said, if you're going to play one of our greatest artists, you better go and learn how to paint. So I did, and I had a brilliant teacher who was an artist and a teacher, and I did, and I've actually got a copy I did of one of Turner's things on the wall, and I look at it now and I think, how the hell did I do that? I can't even remember doing it.
So you don't continue, you paint yourself?
I paint now, I do, and I stopped for a long time, and then when I did the Lowry, I just couldn't stop. I just painted and painted and painted. I go on the set and they said, there's paint all over your fingers. I said, well, I'm playing a painter. He said, it's the wrong colours. No, we didn't. So now I carried on. And I do it, yeah, I paint, yeah. I'm surprised I do, but there we are, I do. And I'm going to have an exhibition next year, and some board has asked me to do an exhibition in a gallery in Chelsea in London, so I know all
it's
of a sudden...
life imitating art.
Well, a bit like that, or just being an upstart late in life, you know, I don't know. I
mean, you don't have any serial killer roles coming up, do you?
I played a hangman, so I'd know exactly what length of rope to give you.
Didn't you have to hang one of your son's best mates?
I did. He came and stayed with us. My son, who's an actor, very, well-known actor now, when he had one of his pals came to live in London, and his girlfriend, and they had nowhere to stay, and they stayed with us, who was also an actor, and he played Timothy Evans, who got, you know, accused of killing all the people that Christie killed. And lo and behold, on the first day, he was the first person I had to hang. Hello, Ben, come on, here we are. that's not the sort of job. Not every day you hang one of your son's best friends, is it?
It's going to be like me with my daughter's first boyfriend.
He recovered.
How do you say what you like about hanging? At least it's an action, you know, at least something is happening. It must be very hard to convey, like, being a painter, it's such a solitary thing, it's very internalised. How do you actually get into that and convey what's happening on the screen?
Well, what's interesting about this piece is that it's a very intense relationship. He happens to be a painter, but abusive, really, but a very close and loving and abusive love relationship about a person who's been brought up to devote their whole life to looking after somebody. And his desire is to please her all the time, and he wants her to understand his art, but she doesn't. And he knows that as much as he's been, you know, almost hardwired to live, to fulfil her every wish, his artistic impulse makes him paint something that reminds her of how they've come down in the world, because they moved from a posh part of Manchester to a poor one because the father lost all their money. And he's a rent collector now, and she's really embarrassed by the fact that she considers paints like a child, has no recognition, and B, he's actually a bit of an embarrassment. And what happens is the film explains that the agony he's got in trying to convince her that what he's doing is good, when you look at the paintings, which are representational, you see there's a kind of, they're far more than just quaint. There's a kind of an odd pain in them, and there's a haunting quality in them that grows out of what this film is about. And it's also very funny, this film, because you can't believe how horrible she can actually be. Also about fun, and it's, you know, it's got a lovely language in it, but it's an exploration of what goes on in the home life of an artist, and it explains the work, you know, hopefully in an interesting and amusing and rather disturbing way.
In a very different guise, you of course played a rat in the Harry Potter franchise.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What was it like to star in that mega franchise with so many greats?
Well, the research was interesting, living down sewers and digging up.
Oh, your method, you went method.
Mainly cheese for 3 years. I mean, that was just a great experience. I mean, to be a part of that thing has almost become a religion, hasn't it, Harry Potter?
I was watching it just the other day with my son, actually. It's extraordinary, yeah.
And every new generation, they're being introduced to it. And every time you go into work, there'd be some icon of British theatre or cinema sitting in there having a snout put on or a pair of horns or something. You know, so no, it was a fascinating thing. What I love about that as well is that, OK, it's a huge commercial franchise, but it's also getting kids to read books,
100%.
Which is a great thing, isn't it? Yeah.
Single, yeah, wonderful thing.